to a new session of Pioneer's Talk. A steel plant is a complex organism with many parts that need to be understood and orchestrated so that the plant reaches its full potential. But what does this metaphor mean in the context of green steel, considering all parts? To discuss this, I have invited Gerhard Kurka. Welcome, Gerhard.
Hello.
Gerhard, you're one of the great logistics specialists of Primetals Technologies. And I would like to ask you, regarding green steel and the manufacturers at play in a steel plant, I feel that most people consider steel making and probably iron making, but not everything else or not so much. Why is this a problem?
Yeah, I think the reason for that is simply that the iron making, the steel making side, contributes the most to the CO2 emission of a steel plant in the production chain. Yeah, especially if you consider, for example, blast furnaces, with approximately 2,000 kilograms CO2 per ton of metal. It's a huge, actually, CO2 emitter.
Actually, I think Alexander Fleischandl has a quote where he says, "We don't produce steel, we produce CO2, and then we produce steel."
So, unfortunately,
so that is the blast furnace right there.
Right. Unfortunately, the steel industry, I think, contributes to about 7 to 8% of the
global
CO2 emissions. And hence, it's important, actually, to bring that down, of course. Yeah, so the hot metal and the steel production facilities surely contribute the most to that CO2 emission. Nevertheless, of course, also the downstream side has its share, and there are also some measures you can take actually to bring that down. If I, for example, mention the ESP as a solution of Primetals.
RVD ESP, endless strip production.
EST, endless strip production, that is linking actually the casting process and the rolling process without the need for a reheating furnace as you need it for a hot strip mill.
It's extremely energy efficient.
Extremely energy efficient, and nowadays, of course, also efficient in terms of a reduced CO2 footprint. Of course, you can also reduce the CO2 emission for hot strip mill or long rolling mills that are operating reheating furnaces based on natural gas, for example. You can reduce the CO2 footprint there by removing the reheating furnace by an induction, electric induction heating furnace or equipment. In that regard, if you have green electricity, you can at least reduce the CO2 emissions for heating up the products actually before entering the rolling stage. Yeah. But certainly the iron phase has the biggest impact here. And in addition, there are also other requirements that always need to be addressed. For example, quality requirements, that means actually not all the products of the customer can be produced using green technology, at least not in every country, every location, and so on. So for example, if you are delivering special grades for the automotive industry, actually that require very, very high purity and so on, then maybe you need to use hot metal based on iron ore. On the other hand, if you are able to achieve that quality based on special process adaptations for the secondary metallurgy, if you can achieve that with an electric arc furnace, okay, highly welcome. Of course, yeah, but it's not often so easy to achieve that grade. And mentioning also other influences there, especially if you are delivering products for automotive applications, you also have to be aware of the fact that the whole production line needs to get certified for your end customers. Yeah, so actually that means if your production hasn't been certified by an authority that it delivers the required grades and so on, yeah, then you cannot sell your products. So if you now make some changes to the production line, you need to recertificate the whole production line, yeah. And even though now it has a reduced CO2 impact, yeah, and maybe also the same quality, let's say based on electric steel making instead of a converter, you cannot sell your product to your customers until you get a new approval that it conforms and complies to all the quality requirements necessary. Yeah? That's also something one has to keep in mind, actually, when talking with different customers here. It also depends here on the customer base. Yeah? Is it high quality? Is it for automotive? Is it for oil rigs, the tube steel, and so on? A lot of influences that doesn't make it very easy to figuring out the best CO2 reduction technology.
Right. So not only is it necessary to consider the entire production route, you also have to look at the country a
yes.
plant is located in,
yes.
The products it's producing,
mm-hmm.
Potentially where the market is going, future
Absolutely.
Products they
yes.
want to make, if they want to shift in terms of portfolio.
Mm-hmm.
This sounds really complex, Gerhard.
Definitely, yeah.
And
yes.
I think you and the team have developed a solution called CO2 Calculator, which helps at least a little bit to handle this complexity. What does it do?
Yeah, as you said, actually, it's a tool that tries to reduce the complexity in that regard. Yeah, you cannot get rid of all the complexity, of course, but complexity in terms of the interdependencies between the production units.
Mm-hmm.
What do I mean by that? For example, if you want to reduce the CO2 emission at a converter plant and you have your BUFs, blast oxygen furnaces there working, you can, for example, increase the scrap ratio, let's say from 10, 11, 12% up to 20%, yeah, which is actually on the higher side.
So you have sliders and you just adjust and
yeah, you can actually, we haven't sliders right in there, but you can just change the ratio directly. And it immediately then calculates you the new CO2 estimation for all the depending production units. That means actually if you add more scrap to your process, you can reduce the hot metal for the process.
Mm-hmm.
If you reduce the hot metal, of course, the CO2 emission of your blast furnace goes down, but also the CO2 emission of the coking plant and the CO2 emission of the sinter plant.
Mm-hmm.
And if you need less raw material, that even can reduce the CO2 emission for transport. Yeah? So you see actually just by playing around with that lever in regarding the ratio of scrap to hot metal, you have to consider a lot of additional components or units in the calculation.
And my understanding is that when you change one parameter and it impacts other aggregates,
yes,
this will be done by the tool.
This will be done by the tool, yeah. So for example, just if you change the production output of your primary steel production unit, like a BUF or electric arc furnace, you get an immediate update of all the raw material requirements and also the CO2 emission at the different locations in the production chain.
Got it. It sounds like this is fabulous for steel producers wanting to investigate what they could
yes.
do in terms of changing their route or their routes. Also, maybe they have fantasy routes that they've always
Definitely.
Wondered
Definitely.
What they would yield and
yeah, yeah.
the CO2 footprint of those. So all this could be done via this tool.
Yes, and you also mentioned here an important aspect. Because, as you see, we have here a very complex dependency across all these units. That means actually, just by thinking I can reduce CO2 to that degree by make any change, that can happen, but it could be that you get a completely different result. Yeah? Mm-hmm. And so actually what you then do is to play around with your fantasies. Yeah, you can actually create different plant configurations, and that is also what it has been built for. For example, a configuration where you add an additional electric arc furnace to complement your BUFs, let's say. Yeah? A version where you replace one of, let's say, three BUFs with an electric arc furnace. Yeah? A version actually where you, add a Midrex, direct reduction module to a blast furnace.
Gerhard, could you even implement future technology like completely hydrogen-based direct reduction?
Yes, we have that in order to give our customers and the user of the tool also an opportunity to check what's in there if they switch 200% hydrogen.
Yeah. So for a long-term strategic planning,
for instance. Long-term strategic planning, yeah. For example, you can add here a direct reduction module that you configure 100% natural gas. And then you can change that actually to hydrogen. Well, you add two of that, yeah, and you change the ratio here, yeah. So you can see, okay, what's when I operate it now with 30% hydrogen, 70% natural gas, actually. Yeah? How will that influence my overall CO2 emission? Yeah?
Great. So this way, steel producers could determine what their roadmap may look like.
Yes. Yes. Exactly. And that's also what the customer from us were asking a few weeks back when I introduced to them the CO2 calculator, because they actually just want to use it at the very high stage, yeah, in a conceptual discussion, as a, let's say, communication tool, yeah, to make it apparent what you get if you make changes throughout the production line. And they don't want to go into the details here. Yeah, it's just, let's say, on a rather high level to separate the ideas that make sense from those that don't. Yeah, and that's also what we see often. The customer, as you say, have a fantasy, of course. They have a lot of valuable ideas, but in order to filter them out arrive then on the, let's say, three most promising, you can use the tool actually. And for the remaining configurations, you can then go into detail, which of course requires more effort.
So you can use your imagination and create from scratch a production route that you've always dreamed of, or that you've envisaged for the future, and see whether it works in a way, and whether
in general,
what the carbon
in general levels. Yes, in general, yes. Of course, there are some restrictions to the production units,
such as the laws of physics.
The laws of physics, and we have currently included, for example, smelter technology. We have included direct reduction based on hydrogen, and so on. But of course, maybe there are future technologies that we are currently not aware of, and that's not in here. The user, of course, has to use the pre-configured production units in that regard.
Sure.
That's the restriction. But otherwise, yeah, you can play around with potential future production routes and figure out what would be that one that meets your requirements best.
Gerhard, this sounds great, and it sounds like CO2 calculator is a really handy tool. What does it cost?
Yeah, it's actually free.
It's free.
It's free. I have to say that years back, when we did our first CO2 study for customers, we developed an internal tool for the emission calculations. And based on that, we derive then the public CO2 calculator. That means actually a lot of development in that regard actually has been done
mm-hmm.
internally.
Mm-hmm.
And the effort also for the for this web-based application isn't in the complexity range of a simulation software, because it's mainly an editor that lets you edit your production route, yeah? And the CO2 values are then estimated based on pre-configured factors for all these processing
mm.
units. Of course, that's not 100% accurate, I have to say here, but it gives you a good guess, actually, and a starting point for additional investigations. It's free, actually, everybody can use it. You just have to register yourself on
mm-hmm.
our website for
mm-hmm.
it.
We will add a link to that
yeah,
page in the description to this
okay.
video.
Okay.
Okay, so it's free, free for everyone. And is it possible to compare these routes, save them and benchmark them, go back to them later, make some further adjustments?
Yes, at the moment the routes can be saved.
Mm-hmm.
And for each route actually that you have saved, you get the immediate scope 1 CO2 emission, scope 2 CO2
that
emission.
That we need to explain
so
later, but
of
continue.
Course, yeah,
uh-huh.
Of course. So actually you can compare the production routes directly regarding CO2 emission. Yeah, in the future, actually, we also want to add here maybe more elaborate measures in order to get a better, better overview of your routes, maybe also in a graphical form. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
At the moment, it's just numbers, but it's a starting point. And also we are looking here to the users actually about the acceptance, but from what I can see now, actually, a lot of registrations up to now. Yeah.
I think it's been quite successful. So
yes, one can say that actually we see up to 200-300 users actually that have registered
mm-hmm.
up to now by themselves. This
in
is just a few
industry,
months.
Yeah, in a niche industry, this is quite good
yes.
for a free
yes.
tool.
Definitely, yes.
You mentioned the scopes.
Yes.
So what
yes.
are the scopes?
Yeah. What are the scopes? Yeah. Actually, when it comes to CO2 calculation, people are talking about three different scopes. We have the scope one.
Mm-hmm.
Scope one actually is the CO2 emission related to the chemical process or
mm-hmm.
to the actual production
okay.
on site. Yeah.
So the site, what happens on
yes.
the site, what happens on the site in terms of carbon emissions?
Yes, yes,
okay.
You can say it that way, yes. Then we have scope two. Scope two actually is an indirect CO2 emission. Indirect in terms of it considers the CO2 emission for the production and the supply and delivering of the required energy for
mm-hmm.
your process. Yeah.
So if you buy in electrical energy from, say, Scandinavia,
yes.
you will have lower scope 2 emissions compared to countries that have coal-based power plants, for instance.
That's right. That's right, actually. When you consider the country-based CO2 emissions here for electricity, we are talking about the so-called conversion factor, a CO2 conversion factor. Yeah, actually, if you have mostly green electricity, yeah, then the emission of CO2 per kilowatt hour
mm-hmm.
is rather low. Yeah,
mm-hmm.
it can go down to zero at best. Yeah. On the other hand, if we look to countries actually that have a lot of coal-powered electrical production. Then you also have to deal with a lot of CO2 produced per kilowatt hour of electricity for your plant. Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
And these factors actually are also stored in the CO2 calculator in a table that comprises a lot of countries which we are having our eyes on, and so try to keep also these conversion factors up to date, because it changes with the energy mix, mm-hmm. as you can imagine. Yeah.
So by saying there's a table implemented, I think that's in the back end somewhere, right? And
yes.
so if you choose the country
yes.
from which you
mm-hmm.
get your energy, it will
right.
then do the math for you.
Exactly. You just have to select the country actually and get an immediate result for your CO2 emission for scope 2. And you can also enter this value manually, of course, because customers often have very specific energy contracts.
Mm-hmm.
So they are not relying solely on the power mix of the country. Yeah,
mm-hmm.
Let's say the electric steel plant has a contract with Scandinavian countries. Yeah, for getting their energy there, and we have such a customer in Germany actually who completely produces green steel,
mm.
since he. Has a contract with the Norwegian plant, a power plant that delivers 100% green energy
mm-hmm.
to him.
Interesting. Okay, so it doesn't matter where you're located. If it's an electric steel plant, you just have to buy in the right energy.
Right, if the grid allows for that, of
mm-hmm.
course, yeah. And yeah, I'm also not an expert regarding electrical power grid, but it seems that in Europe actually our power grid infrastructure is sufficiently elaborated so that we can cross borders there regarding the energy delivery and making also contracts with different countries.
Mm.
So to get or to bring the steel production into the green range, let's call it
right.
that way. Yeah.
That's yet another way in which you've already anticipated future developments with a CO2 calculator. So technology-wise, hydrogen
mm-hmm.
and where to buy an energy. So this is really nice.
Yes, the energy question is also an important one. Some weeks ago, we received also a request from a Primetals employee
mm-hmm.
that it would be nice actually to add here the total amount of electric energy needed for the process in addition to the CO2 emission. And currently we are in developing or adding this feature to the CO2 calculator, and in a few weeks actually it will go online. So then you don't just can calculate the CO2 emission, you also get then an estimation for the overall electrical energy needed for the process, which of course is very important if you go for electric steel making or would like to add electric arc furnaces to your steel plant, which consume of course a lot of electrical power.
Very hot topic in Europe.
Definitely, yes.
Let's sum up. CO2 calculator. It's a free tool. You can create customized production routes.
Yes.
You can also choose some that are pre-configured and compare
yes,
them.
Yes, yes. In order to make it easier for people, when they first start with the CO2 calculator, there are 5 different pre-configured production routes. Yeah, from different areas. Yeah, 100% BOF-based converter steel making, electric arc steel making, with direct reduction, and so on. And so actually you can choose from that, yeah, and can, let's say, that use as a starting point for your own experiments.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that really reduces the effort necessary for starting with the first plant configuration.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Also to learn how to use the tool.
Yes.
You can tweak some settings and...
Can exactly.
There's, I think, also a tutorial built in.
Yes, there's also some sort of guideline and tutorial, actually, that gets you through the program, if you would like to.
Mm-hmm.
You can, of course, skip it also.
Yeah, I think you're the skipping
yes,
kind.
Yes, I'm
right?
in the skipping mode, yes. So actually, it should make it easier
mm-hmm.
For people, actually, to get in touch with this software.
Yeah, sounds great, Gerhard. Are there any updates planned?
In general, actually, we are open for requests from our customers and also from our users regarding the tool. And of course, we cannot add each requested feature. Otherwise, we would work 100% on this.
I think you're also working on other stuff besides CO2 calculator.
Definitely. But of course, I think so. From what I can see now, actually, there will be one update at least per year or at least every 6 months, which addresses the most asked for features if they can be incorporated in the software.
Awesome. So I think this is another reason why more people will jump in. And if you haven't yet tried CO2 Calculator, Gerhard and I invite you to give it a test run, and hopefully you'll also use your imagination and build the perfect production route for your company. Should you have any questions, let us know. There's a couple of ways you can. This is the world of social media. Just reach out, and Gerhard and the team will be happy to answer any questions you may have. Gerhard, that brings us to the end of this Pioneers Talk. Thanks for being here. And I look forward to speaking with you again when there's updates to CO2 Calculator or maybe other topics that we have in common.
Of course. Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity of this interview.
Thank you for watching. See you soon.
Thanks.